Learn how you can do things like use Azure SQL Database from a Synapse workspace this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Armando. Armando, thanks so much for joining us today. Can you give us a little bit of info about what you do?
Hi, Anna. Good to be here. Thanks for having me. I do data architect and cloud deployment architect for data platform in Azure. I've been MVP for a couple of years and also been a consultant for over 20 years. But I don't like to talk much about that.
Awesome. Well, it's great to have you on the show. And today we're going to be talking about something I don't know a ton about, and that is choosing the right SQL engine size when you're working with Synapse. So I'd love to, before we get into the scenario, like understand a little bit more about like how you came up with this scenario in the first place.
Sure. So as a consultant, companies come to us all the time. They came with their use cases. And when it comes to Synapse, usually we address big data volumes, you know, petabytes scale size. A couple of years ago, we had a customer with a couple petabytes to move up to the cloud, and Synapse is the right place for those things. And back in the days of SQL DW, that's the idea, right? If you have over 10, 15 terabytes, you could start thinking about using SQL DW and now Synapse. But there are a lot of use cases out there where people have very small data sets. They don't get to 1 terabyte. They get 200, 400, 500 gigabytes. But they still want to use Spark. They still want to use the parallelism that we see in Synapse and all the integration we find in Synapse. And they look into Synapse, and the only thing they see is the dedicated SQL pool and the serverless SQL pool. And the dedicated SQL pool means a lot of money. And usually when we're talking about small data sets, we're talking about a small budget. So I came up with this topic, assisting these customers with small data sets to fit their data sets into the Synapse environment and also fit in their budget.
Awesome, cool. It makes a lot of sense. I'd love to take a look.
Yeah, let's talk about this here just quick. Let me get here my other screen where I have some designs to show you. So when people talking about Synapse, nowadays, most people know that we have 4 engines inside Synapse. Actually, it's 3, and we have an integrated environment in the pipelines, transformation pipelines. But we have the dedicated SQL pool. We have the Spark pool inside Synapse. And we have the serverless SQL pool, which is super interesting, right? That goes back into the lake where you can query parquet files straight from the lake. For small data sets, usually the serverless SQL pool, which would be the alternative to have the dedicated SQL pool running all the time, would fit in those cases. But when you have very small data sets and you have to query the database quite often, usually for small data sets, you don't have the best performance in here because the serverless SQL pool is designed, again, for very large data sets. And it takes a few seconds to spin up the underlying engine and collect the data from the parquet files. So the idea is, can I add another data engine into this environment? And what most people don't realize is that Synapse is not just the 4 engines that are in there, but it's the workspace. And unlike Azure Data Flow, which is a great resource, a great tool in Azure too for data transformations, in Azure Data Flow, we have this thing called the linked service to connect to the data sources. When you go into Synapse, you also find this linked service. But because the linked service belongs to the workspace, you have some latitude. You can do some extra stuff into there. So the whole idea is to focus on the workspace configuration. So your linked service will, in that case, could be a regular SQL offering, would be almost like one extra engine added to the workspace, like you can do with Power BI, for instance. So the whole idea is when you have a data pipeline like this, you know, very simple diagramming here, the whole idea is by default, this would be my data engine for SQL, SQL processing, SQL data crunching, would be the dedicated SQL pool, too expensive and designed for larger data volumes than what I have in my small data sets. the idea is to flip this one to a regular SQL offering. And which SQL offering would that be? Well, the one that would better fit the use case, right? The two ones I've been using most is the hyperscale due to the speed of data transfer. It's faster than any other offering, but usually it's, the cost is justified when people are querying the database quite often. And when the database is like, it refreshes a data set in Power BI once a day or twice a day or less often, you would use the serverless, one of the serverless options, right? General purpose or business critical. So let me show you how we can do this, how we can get this SQL offering inside Synapse. So let me get myself down here and let's get to the browser. So here we have my subscription in Azure. And as you can see, the only things that I have in here is a regular Synapse deployment and one SQL Server hyperscale. This is the one I want to add into Synapse. So in order for this SQL being kind of a transparent into the workspace to integrate into the workspace, I have to go into the workspace and add a linked service. So, nothing special into that one in there. The idea is to come here into the linked service and add that SQL instance over here. One of the tricks to help things get easier and somewhat faster to develop things after we implemented this is to use the identity of the workspace inside SQL Server. I can come here and create a little linked service and say it's SQL, Azure SQL database, and connect to that Azure SQL database from my workspace. Let me see here, server name, I have one here. I call it Financial Mart. Actually, the server, so it's Financial Mart server. And the database is my Financial Mart database, which is empty, it's just an asset there for connectivity. So SQL authentication would be less than ideal, right? If we want to have a key vault for that to store the password in these things, what we really want to have is to have the workspace authenticated in there. So what we do is we flip into SQL and we add the workspace, the actual workspace name. When you create Synapse, it adds a managed identity automatically during deployment. So the idea is to add that the workspace identity into the database and give enough permission to the database in there, to the workspace in the database. So this, there we go. We added it in there. And we can go back into the workspace and say, you know what? I want to do SQL authentication. No, what I want to do is manage identity, which is the identity of the workspace I just added into SQL. So that is going to make it feel to the workspace almost like the dedicated SQL service, because all other elements of the workspace, like the Spark pool, the transformation pipelines, and everything else that could be in there, we'll be able to authenticate straight through. I don't have to authenticate the users. I don't have to authenticate anybody else. It's just another resource inside the workspace. And once that is done, I can, do my transformations. I can go into the transformation pipelines and start doing my transformations over there, which is what we need to do. From here on, I can just do all my queries, all the elements to the SQL database as it was the dedicated SQL pool. The only thing I don't have, which would be nice, is kind of an idea I have already given to the product group, is that when you add a linked service over here in Synapse, if it is a storage data lake, it would show here. But if it's SQL, it doesn't. It would be great if it would show up here, but it doesn't. But you can use the SQL from the regular tools, from Visual Studio Code and everything else.
Wow, Armando, this is really cool. I had no idea that you could kind of link these things together, especially the managed identity piece was pretty cool. One question though, if you're moving from using a dedicated SQL pool to just a SQL database, hyperscale or serverless, are there any issues with scaling since it's not MPP like dedicated SQL pool would be?
Yes, great question, exactly. we have this problem because of the SQL offerings, all other SQL offerings, they are SMP, right? They are symmetric multiprocessing offerings, which means that if the pipeline, for instance, goes into the database and establishes just one connection and I have like 80 cores in that connection, in that database, you would never be able to use the entire collection of resources because of the design of the platform. So the whole idea, in order to keep scale, if you need to scale within this platform, is to move the data crunching out of SQL, not implementing as stored procedure or anything like that, but implementing as transformations, either as a Spark pool Python code, Scala code, whatever language you want to use, or in this case here, using the data flow. One important tip in order to keep scaling, you know, be able to scale this out as needed until it's not scalable anymore, is the right design of the table in the database. So partitioning in hyperscale is possible. We cannot physical partition, but you can logically partition your table. So if you partition your table, if you use the partition options in there, you can come in here and define multiple sources, one for each partition you may have. And within the data flow, you can do a union of these elements and use the Spark, the cluster supported by Spark to do all the internal partitioning for data crunching so you can get the scalability you just asked about. And very important, when it's time to write, to sync this data, you would split the data pipeline into all the partitions. You know, if the final crunch after you have aggregated the whole data set, if it's still that big, you can come in here and define multiple sync targets to the same table, to the same database. And as you do this, it's important to keep in mind that this same table in the same database must not have a clustered index, because when you do that, you queue parallelism in the database side. But if you keep all the index non-clustered, or if you use column store indexes in SQL, you can come in here and define the sync, all these four syncs to the same table. And very important, big trick in here. if you click on the white area of the data flow, go into settings, and here in the settings, you define that all these syncs, they belong to the same write order. This is half of what we have to do for scalability. So it means you're creating a lot of parallel connections into SQL. What is it? Here, into SQL. So these guys, they will write together. And of course, this is a data flow. For a data flow to run, you need a pipeline with a data flow call. And in the data flow call, you just have to come down here into the sync properties and reminds the integration runtime that you want to run those four sync into the same table in parallel. So this is how you can scale, because the SMP design into SQL, hyperscale, general purpose, whatever it is, we'll see multiple sessions coming in right into the same table, and then you'll be able to scale up to the amount of cores you have allocated to your database.
Thanks. That's really cool. I had no idea it could be that easy to kind of get the scale with an SMP database in Synapse workspaces. So this has been really cool. You know, when we think about the overall solution that you showed us today, it was really interesting. Are there any like limitations that you feel like we should call out or people should be aware of when they go to maybe implement this?
Yes, of course. The limitations are pretty much the SQL database itself. So the amount of cores you have will limit the amount of memory you have and the amount of parallel sessions that will be supported by SQL, right? When data flow comes in and start collecting data. The same goes when you're writing. So it's very important to emphasize that the table must not have a clustered index on it. Otherwise, the parallelism goes away. So these are big, important limitations. The other one is if you don't go for hyperscale is the only one that has, you know, up to 100 megabits per second writing to the transaction log. So all other ones, they will be slower than hyperscale. So usually hyperscale is a better option in terms of performance when writing volume. And when the data is too big to fit in a SQL offering, then more likely you have a data set that's worth of the dedicated SQL pool.
Awesome. Those are great tips. And Armando, this has been really interesting. I've learned a lot. I have no idea that you could kind of use SQL database in Synapse workspaces in this way or other SQL offerings. So thanks so much for coming on the show. To our viewers, if you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like. Leave us a comment and let us know what you think of this scenario. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.